The History of King Lear by Nahum Tate. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Dramatis Personae.
King Lear.
Read by Bob Gonzalez.
Gloucester. Read by Martin Geeson. Kent.
Read by Ariel Lipshaw.
Edgar.
Read by Dublin Gothic.
Edmund the Bastard.
Read by Elizabeth Klett.
Cornwall.
Read by David Goldfarb.
Cornwall's Servant, Old Man and Gentleman.
Read by Algy Pug.
Albany.
Read by Noel Badrian.
Burgundy and Physician.
Read by James Curtis.
Goneril's Gentleman Usher.
Read by Christine G.
Attendant and Messenger.
Read by C. Jacob A.
Arante, Cordelia's Attendant, and Herald.
Read by Tiffany Halla Colonna.
Attendant, read by Phil Chenevere.
First Ruffian and Officer.
Read by Nathaniel W. C. Higgins.
Second Ruffian and Captain.
Read by Robert Hoffman.
Goneril.
Read by Bev Stevens.
Regan.
Read by Liberty Stump.
Cordelia.
Read by Miss Avarice.
Narrator.
Read by Algy Pug.
Introduction and Prologue to the History of King Lear by Nahum Tate. Read by Martin Geeson. Epistle dedicatory to my esteemed friend Thomas Butler, Esquire. Sir, you have a natural right to this piece, since by your advice I attempted the revival of it with alterations. Nothing but the power of your persuasion and my zeal for all the remains of Shakespeare could have wrought me to so bold an undertaking. I found that the new modelling of this story would force me sometimes on the difficult task of making the chiefest persons speak something like their character on matter whereon I had no ground in my author. Lear's real and Edgar's pretended madness have so much of extravagant nature, I know not how else to express it, as could never have started but from our Shakespeare's creating fancy. The images and language are so odd and surprising, and yet so agreeable and proper, that whilst we grant that none but Shakespeare could have formed such conceptions, yet we are satisfied that they were the only things in the world that ought to be said on those occasions. I found the whole to answer your account of it, a heap of jewels, unstrung and unpolished, yet so dazzling in their disorder that I soon perceived I had seized a treasure. 'Twas my good fortune to light on one expedient to rectify what was wanting in the regularity and probability of the tale, which was to run through the whole a love betwixt Edgar and Cordelia, that never changed word with each other in the original. This renders Cordelia's indifference and her father's passion in the first scene probable. It likewise gives countenance to Edgar's disguise, making that a generous design that was before a poor shift to save his life. The distress of the story is evidently heightened by it, and it particularly gave occasion of a new scene or two, of more success, perhaps, than merit. This method necessarily threw me on making the tale conclude in a success to the innocent distressed persons. Otherwise I must have encumbered the stage with dead bodies, which conduct makes many tragedies conclude with unseasonable jests. Yet I was racked with no small fears for so bold a change, till I found it well received by my audience. And if this will not satisfy the reader, I can produce an authority that questionless will. Marginal note. Mr. Dryden, preface to the Spanish Friar. Neither is it of so trivial an undertaking to make a tragedy end happily, for 'tis more difficult to save than 'tis to kill. The dagger and cup of poison are always in readiness, but to bring the action to the last extremity, and then by probable means to recover all, will require the art and judgment of a writer, and cost him many a pang in the performance. I have one thing more to apologize for, which is that I have used less quaintness of expression even in the newest parts of this play. I confess 'twas design in me, partly to comply with my author's style, to make the scenes of a piece, and partly to give it some resemblance of the time and persons here represented. This, sir, I submit wholly to you, who are both a judge and master of style. Nature had exempted you, before you went abroad, from the morose, saturnine humour of our country, and you brought home the refinedness of travel, without the affectation. Many faults I see in the following pages, and question not but you will discover more, yet I will presume so far on your friendship as to make the whole a present to you, and subscribe myself your obliged friend and humble servant, N. Tate. Prologue. Ha! Since by mistakes your best delights are made, for even your wives can please in masquerade, 'twere worth our while to have drawn you in this day by a new name to our old honest play. But he that did this evening's treat prepare, bluntly resolved beforehand to declare your entertainment should be most old fare. Yet hopes, since in rich Shakespeare's soil it grew, 'twill relish yet with those whose tastes are true, and his ambition is to please a few. If then this heap of flowers should chance to wear fresh beauty in the order they now bear, even this Shakespeare's praise. Each rustic knows, mongst plenteous flowers, a garland to compose, which, strung by his coarse hand, may fairer show. But 'twas a power divine first made 'em grow. Why should these scenes lie hid, in which we find what may at once divert and teach the mind? Morals were always proper for the stage, but are even necessary in this age. Poets must take the church's teaching trade, since priests their province of intrigue invade. That we the worst in this exchange have got, in vain our poets preach, whilst churchmen plot.
Act 1. Scene 1. Enter Bastard Solus.
Thou, Nature, art my goddess. To thy law my services abound. Why am I then deprived of a son's right because I came not in the dull road that custom has prescribed? Why, bastard, wherefore base? When I can boast a mind as generous and a shape as true as honest madam's issue, why are we held base, who in the lusty stealth of nature take fiercer qualities than what compound the scanted births of the stale marriage-bed. Well, then, legitimate Edgar, to thy right of law I will oppose a bastard's cunning. Our father's love is to the bastard Edmund as to legitimate Edgar. With success I've practised yet on both their easy natures. Here comes the old man chaffed with the information which last I forged against my brother Edgar, a tale so plausible, so boldly uttered, and heightened by such lucky accidents, that now the slightest circumstance confirms him, and base-born Edmund, spite of law, inherits.
Enter Kent and Gloucester.
Nay, good my lord, your charity o'ershoots itself to plead in his behalf. You are yourself a father, and may feel the sting of disobedience from a son, first-born and best-beloved. Oh, villain Edgar!
Be not too rash. All may be forgery, and time yet clear the duty of your son.
Plead with the seas, and reason down the winds, yet shalt thou ne'er convince me. I have seen his foul designs through all a father's fondness. But be this light, and thou my witnesses, that I discard him here from my possessions, divorce him from my heart, my blood and name.
It works as I could wish. I'll show myself.
Oh, Edmund, welcome, boy! Oh, Kent, see here inverted nature, Gloucester's shame and glory. This byborn, the wild sally of my youth, pursues me with all filial offices, whilst Edgar, begged of heaven and born in honour, draws plagues on my white head, that urge me still to curse in age the pleasure of my youth. Nay, weep not, Edmund, for thy brother's crimes. O, generous boy, thou sharest but half his blood, yet lov'st beyond the kindness of a brother. But I'll reward thy virtue. Follow me. My lord, you wait the king, who comes resolved to quit the toils of empire, and divide his realms amongst his daughters. Heaven succeed it, but much I fear the change.
I grieve to see him, with such wild starts of passion hourly seized, as renders majesty beneath itself.
Alas, 'tis the infirmity of his age. Yet has his temper ever been unfixed, choleric and sudden. Hark, they approach.
Exeunt Gloucester and a bastard. Scene 2. Flourish. Enter Lear, Cornwall, Albany, Burgundy, Edgar, Goneril, Regan, Cordelia. Edgar speaking to Cordelia at entrance.
Cordelia, royal fair, turn yet once more, and ere successful Burgundy receive the treasure of thy beauties from the king, ere happy Burgundy for ever fold thee, cast back one pitying look on wretched Edgar.
Alas, what would the wretched Edgar with the more unfortunate Cordelia, who in obedience to a father's will flies from her Edgar's arms to Burgundy's?
Attend, my lords of Albany and Cornwall, with princely Burgundy.
We do, my liege.
Give me the map. Know, lords, we have divided in three our kingdom, having now resolved to disengage from our long toil of state, conferring all upon your younger years. You, Burgundy, Cornwall, and Albany, long in our court have made your amorous sojourn, and now are to be answered. Tell me, my daughters, which of you loves us most, that we may place our largest bounty with the largest merit? Goneril, our eldest born, speak first.
Sir, I do love you more than words can utter, beyond what can be valued, rich or rare, Nor liberty, nor sight, health, fame, or beauty are half so dear. My life for you were vile, as much as child can love the best of fathers.
Of all these bounds, e'en from this line to this, with shady forests and wide-skirted meads, we make thee lady. To thine and Albany's issue, be this perpetual. What says our second daughter?
My sister, sir, in part expressed my love, for such as hers is mine, though more extended. Sense has no other joy than I can relish. I have my all in my dear liege's love.
Therefore to thee and thine hereditary remain this ample third of our fair kingdom.
Aside.
Now comes my trial. How am I distressed, that must with cold speech tempt the choleric king, rather to leave me dowerless than condemn me to loathed embraces.
Speak now, our last, not least in our dear love. So ends my task of state. Cordelia, speak. What canst thou say to win a richer third than what thy sisters gained?
Now must my love in words fall short of theirs, as much as it exceeds in truth. Nothing, my lord.
Nothing can come of nothing. Speak again.
Unhappy I am that I can't dissemble, sir, as I ought. I love your majesty, no more nor less.
Take heed, Cordelia, thy fortunes are at stake. Think better on't, and mend thy speech a little.
O my liege, you gave me being, bred me, dearly loved me, and I return my duty as I ought, obey you, love you, and most honour you. Why have my sisters husbands, if they love you all? Happily when I shall wed, the lord whose hand shall take my plight will carry half my love, for I shall never marry, like my sisters, to love my father all.
And goes thy heart with this? 'Tis said that I am choleric. Judge me, gods, is there not cause? Now, minion, I perceive the truth of what has been suggested to us, thy fondness for the rebel son of Gloucester, false to his father as thou art to my hopes. And, oh, take heed, rash girl, lest we comply with thy fond wishes, which thou wilt too late repent. For no, our nature cannot brook a child so young and so ungentle.
So young, my lord, and true.
Thy truth, then, be thy dower, for by the sacred sun and solemn night, I here disclaim all my paternal care, and from this minute hold thee as a stranger both to my blood and favour.
This is frenzy. Consider, good my liege.
Peace, Kent. Come not between a dragon and his rage. I loved her most, and in her tender trust designed to have bestowed my age at ease. So be my grave my peace, as here I give my heart from her, and with it all my wealth. My lords of Cornwall and of Albany, I do invest you jointly with full right in this fair third, Cordelia's forfeit dower. Mark me, my lords, observe our last resolve. Ourself attended with 100 knights, we'll make abroad with you in monthly course. The name alone of king remain with me. Yours be the execution and revenues. This is our final will, and to confirm it, this coronet part between you.
Royal Lear, whom I have ever honored as my king, loved as my father, as my master followed, and as my patron thought on in my prayers.
Away, the bow is bent. Make from the shaft.
No, let it fall and drench within my heart. Be Kent unmannerly when Lear is mad? Thy youngest daughter.
On thy life, no more.
What wilt thou do, old man?
Out of my sight.
See better first.
Now, by the gods!
Now, by the gods, rash king, thou swear'st in vain.
Ha! Traitor!
Do, kill thy physician, Lear. Strike through my throat. Yet with my latest breath I'll thunder in thine ear my just complaint, and tell thee to thy face that thou dost ill.
Hear me, rash man, on thy allegiance, hear me. Since thou hast striven to make us break our vow, and pressed between our sentence and our power, which nor our nature nor our place can bear, we banish thee forever from our sight and kingdom. If when 3 days are expired, thy hated trunk be found in our dominions, that moment is thy death. Away!
Why, fare thee well, king. Since thou art resolved, I take thee at thy word, and will not stay to see thy fall. The gods protect the maid that truly thinks and has most justly said. Thus to new climates my old truth I bear. Friendship lives hence, and banishment is here.
Exit.
Now, Burgundy, you see her price is fall'n, yet if the fondness of your passion still affects her as she stands, dowerless and lost in our esteem, she's yours. Take her or leave her.
Pardon me, Royal Lear, I but demand the dower yourself proposed. And here I take Cordelia by the hand, Duchess of Burgundy.
Then leave her, sir, for by a father's rage I tell you all her wealth. Away.
Then, sir, be pleased to charge the breach of our alliance on your own will, not my inconstancy.
Exeunt. Manent Edgar and Cordelia.
Has heaven then weighed the merit of my love, or is the raving of my sickly thought? Could Burgundy forgo so rich a prize, and leave her to despairing Edgar's arms? Have I thy hand, Cordelia? Do I clasp it? The hand that was this minute to have joined my hated rivals? Do I kneel before thee, and offer at thy feet my panting heart? Smile, princess, and convince me, for as yet I doubt, and dare not trust the dazzling joy.
Some comfort yet that 'twas no vicious blot, that has deprived me of a father's grace, but merely want of that that makes me rich, in wanting it, a smooth professing tongue. O sisters, I am loth to call your fault, as it deserves, but use our father well, and wrong Cordelia never shall repine.
O heavenly maiden, that art thyself thy dower, richer in virtue than the stars in light. If Edgar's humble fortunes may be graced with thy acceptance, at thy feet he lays them. Ah, my Cordelia, dost thou turn away? What have I done to offend thee?
Talked of love.
Then I've offended oft. Cordelia, too, has oft permitted me so to offend.
When, Edgar, I permitted your addresses, I was the darling daughter of a king. Nor can I now forget my royal birth, and live dependent on my lover's fortune. I cannot to so low a fate submit, and therefore study to forget your passion, and trouble me upon this theme no more.
Thus majesty takes most state and distress. How are we tossed on fortune's fickle flood? The wave that with surprising kindness brought the dear wreck to my arms has snatched it back and left me mourning on the barren shore.
Aside.
This baseness of the ignoble Burgundy draws just suspicion on the race of men. His love was interest, so may Edgar's be, and he but with more compliment dissemble. If so, I shall oblige him by denying. But if his love be fixed, such constant flame as warms our breasts, if such I find his passion, my heart as grateful to his truth shall be, and cold Cordelia prove as kind as he.
Exit. Enter Bastard hastily.
Brother, I found you in a lucky minute. Fly and be safe. Some villain has incensed our father against your life.
Distressed Cordelia! But oh, more cruel!
Hear me, sir, your life's in danger.
A resolve so sudden, and of such black importance.
'Twas not sudden. Some villain has of long time laid the train.
And yet perhaps 'twas but pretended coldness, to try how far my passion would pursue.
He hears me not. Wake, wake, sir.
Say ye, brother? No tears, good Edmund. If thou bring'st me tidings to strike me dead, for charity delay not. That present will befit so kind a hand.
Your danger, sir, comes on so fast that I want time to inform you. But retire whilst I take care to turn the pressing stream. Oh, gods, for heaven's sake, sir!
Pardon me, sir. A serious thought had seized me. But I think you talked of danger and wished me to retire. Must all our vows end thus? Friend, I obey you. O Cordelia!
Exit.
Fond man! Such credulous honesty lessens the glory of my artifice. His nature is so far from doing wrongs that he suspects none. If this letter speed and pass for Edgar's, as himself would own the counterfeit but for the foul contents, then my designs are perfect. Here comes Gloucester.
Enter Gloucester.
Stay, Edmund. Turn. What paper were you reading?
A trifle, sir.
What needed, then, that terrible dispatch of it into your pocket? Come, produce it, sir.
A letter from my brother, sir. I had just broke the seal, but knew not the contents. Yet, fearing they might prove to blame, endeavoured to conceal it from your sight.
'Tis Edgar's character.
Reads.
This policy of father's is intolerable, that keeps our fortunes from us till age will not suffer us to enjoy 'em. I am weary of the tyranny. Come to me, that of this I may speak more. If our father would sleep till I waked him, you should enjoy half his possessions, and live beloved of your brother Edgar. Slept till I wake him, you should enjoy half his possessions. Edgar to write this, gainst his indulgent father. Death and hell! Fly, Edmund, seek him out. Wind me into him, that I may bite the traitor's heart, and fold his bleeding entrails on my vengeful arm.
Perhaps 'twas writ, my lord, to prove my virtue.
These late eclipses of the sun and moon can bode no less. Love cools and friendship fails. In cities, mutiny. In countries, discord. The bond of nature cracked 'twixt son and father. Find out the villain. Do it carefully, and it shall lose thee nothing.
Exit.
So now my project's firm. But to make sure, I'll throw in one proof more, and that a bold one. I'll place old Gloucester, where he shall o'erhear us, confer of this design, whilst to his thinking deluded Edgar shall accuse himself. Be honesty my interest, and I can be honest too, and what saint so divine that will successful villainy decline?
Exit. Scene 3. Enter Kent, disguised.
Now, banished Kent, if thou canst pay thy duty in this disguise where thou dost stand condemned, thy master Lear shall find thee full of labours.
Enter Lear, attended.
In there, and tell our daughter we are here now. What art thou?
A man, sir.
What dost thou profess, or wouldst with us?
I do profess to be no less than I seem, to serve him truly that puts me in trust, to love him that's honest, to converse with him that's wise and speaks little, to fight when I can't choose, and to eat no fish.
I say, what art thou?
A very honest-hearted fellow, and as poor as the king.
Then art thou poor indeed. What canst thou do?
I can keep honest counsel, mar a curious tale in the telling, deliver a plain message bluntly, That which ordinary men are fit for, I am qualified in, and the best of me is diligence.
Follow me. Thou shalt serve me.
Enter one of Goneril's gentlemen.
Now, sir?
Sup?
Exit. Kent runs after him.
What says the fellow? Call the clatpole back.
My lord, I know not, but methinks your highness is entertained with slender ceremony.
Who says, my lord, your daughter is not well?
Why came not the slave back when I called him?
My lord, he answered me in the surliest manner, that he would not. Re-enter gentleman brought in by Kent.
I hope our daughter did not so instruct him. Now, who am I, sir?
My lady's father.
My lord's knave.
Strikes him. Goneril at the entrance.
I'll not be struck, my lord.
Nor tripped neither, thou vile civet box.
Strikes up his heels.
By day and night this is insufferable. I will not bear it.
Now, daughter, why that frontlet on? Speak, does that frown become our presence?
Sir, this licentious insolence of your servants is most unseemly. Hourly they break out in quarrels bred by their unbounded riots. I had fair hope, by making this known to you, to have had a quick redress, but find, too late, that you protect and countenance their outrage. And therefore, sir, I take this freedom, which necessity makes discreet.
Are you our daughter?
Come, sir, let me entreat you to make use of your discretion, and put off betimes this disposition that of late transforms you from what you rightly are.
Does any here know me? Why, this is not Lear. Does Lear walk thus, speak thus? Where are his eyes? Who is it that can tell me who I am?
Come, sir, this admiration's much of the savour of other your new humours. I beseech you to understand my purposes aright. As you are old, you should be staid and wise. Here do you keep 100 knights and squires, men so debauched and bold that this our palace shows like a riotous inn, a tavern, brothel. Be then advised by her that else will take that which she begs, to lessen your attendance. Take half away, and see that the remainder be such as may befit your age, and know themselves and you.
Darkness and devils! Saddle my horses, call my train together. Degenerate viper, I'll not stay with thee. I yet have left a daughter. Serpent! Monster! Lessen my train and call 'em riotous! All men approved of choice and rarest parts that each particular of duty know. How small, Cordelia, was thy fault! O Lear, beat at this gate that let thy folly in, and thy dear judgment out. Go, go, my people.
Going off, meets Albany entering.
Ingrateful Duke, was this your will?
What, sir?
Death! 50 of my followers at a clap.
The matter, madam?
Never afflict yourself to know the cause, but give his dotage way.
Blasts upon thee! The untempted woundings of a father's curse pierce every sense about thee. Old fond eyes, lament this cause again. I'll pluck ye out and cast ye with the waters that ye lose to temper clay. No, Gorgon, thou shalt find that I'll resume the shape which thou dost think I have cast off for ever.
Mark ye that.
Hear, nature! Dear goddess, hear! And if thou dost intend to make that creature fruitful, change thy purpose. Pronounce upon her womb the barren curse, that from her blasted body never spring a babe to honor her. But if she must bring forth, defeat her joy with some distorted birth, or monstrous form, the prodigy of the time, and so perverse of spirit, that it may live her torment as 'twas born, to fret her cheeks with constant tears, and wrinkle her young brow, turn all her mother's pains to shame and scorn, that she may curse her crime too late, and feel how sharper than a serpent's tooth it is to have a thankless child. Away, away!
Exit cum suis.
Presuming thus upon his numerous train, he thinks to play the tyrant here, and hold our lives at will.
Well, you may bear too far.
Exit. End of the first act. Act 2 of The History of King Lear by Nahum Tate. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Act 2. Scene. Gloucester's House. Scene 1. Enter Bastard.
The Duke comes here tonight. I'll take advantage of his arrival to complete my project. Brother, a word. Come forth. 'Tis I, your friend.
Enter Edgar.
My father watches for you. Fly this place. Intelligence is given where you are hid. Take the advantage of the night. Bethink ye, have not spoke against the Duke of Cornwall something that might show you a favour of Duke Albany's party?
Nothing. Why ask you?
Because he's coming here tonight, in haste, and Regan with him. Hark! The guards! Away!
Let them come on. I'll stay and clear myself.
Your innocence at leisure may be heard, but Gloucester's storming rage as yet is deaf, and you may perish ere allowed the hearing.
Exit Edgar.
Gloucester comes yonder. Now to my feigned scuffle. Yield! Come before my father! Lights here, lights! Some blood drawn on me would beget opinion.
Stabs his arm.
Of our more fierce encounter. I have seen drunkards do more than this in sport.
Enter Gloucester and servants.
Now, Edmund, where's the traitor?
Oh, that name, sir, strikes horror through me. But my brother, sir, stood here in the dark.
Thou bleed'st. Pursue the villain and bring him piecemeal to me.
Sir, he's fled.
Let him fly far. This kingdom shall not hide him. The noble duke, my patron, comes to-night. By his authority I will proclaim rewards for him that brings him to the stake, and death for the concealer. Then of my lands, loyal and natural boy, I'll work the means to make thee capable.
Exeunt. Scene 2. Enter Kent, disguised still, and Goneril's gentlemen severally.
Good morrow, friend. Belongst thou to this house?
Ask them, we'll answer thee.
Where may we set our horses?
I' the mire.
I am in haste. Prithee, an thou lov'st me, tell me.
I love thee not.
Why, then, I care not for thee.
An I had thee in Lipsbury Pinfold, I'd make thee care for me.
What dost thou mean? I know thee not.
But, minion, I know thee.
What dost thou know me for?
For a base, proud, beggarly, white-livered, glass-gazing, super-serviceable, finical rogue, one that would be a pimp in way of good service, and art nothing but a composition of knave, beggar, coward, pander.
What a monstrous fellow art thou, to rail at one that is neither known of thee nor knows thee.
Impudent slave, not know me, who but 2 days since tripped up thy heels before the king. Draw, miscreant, or I'll make the moon shine through thee.
What means the fellow? Why, prithee, prithee, I tell thee I have nothing to do with thee.
I know your rogueship's office. You come with letters against the king, taking my young lady Vanity's part against her royal father. Draw, rascal!
Mirtha, Mirtha, help, ho!
Dost thou scream, peacock? Strike, puppet! Stand, dapper, slave!
Help, he! Mirtha, Help!
Exit. Kent after him. Scene 3. Flourish. Enter Duke of Cornwall, Regan, attended, Gloucester, bastard.
All welcome to your graces. You do me honour.
Gloucester, we have heard with sorrow that your life has been attempted by your impious son, but Edmund here has paid you strictest duty.
He did betray his practice, and received the hurt you see, striving to apprehend him.
Is he pursued?
He is, my lord.
Use our authority to apprehend the traitor, and do justice on his head. For you, Edmund, that have so signalized your virtue, you from henceforth shall be ours. Natures of such firm trust we much shall need.
Aside.
A charming youth, and worth my further thought.
Lay comforts, noble Gloucester, to your breast, as we to ours. This night be spent in revels. We choose you, Gloucester, for our host to-night. A troublesome expression of our love. On to the sports before us. Who are these?
Enter the gentleman pursued by Kent.
Now, what's the matter?
Keep peace. Upon your lives he dies that strikes. Whence and what are ye?
Sir, they are messengers, the one from your sister, the other from the king.
Your difference. Speak.
I am scarce in breath, my lord.
No marvel. You have so bestirred your valour. Nature disclaims the dastard. A tailor made him.
Speak yet. How grew your quarrel?
Sir, this old ruffian here, whose life I spared in pity to his beard.
Thou essence bottle, in pity to my beard! Your leave, my lord, and I will tread the muscat into mortar.
Know'st thou our presence?
Yes, sir, but anger has a privilege.
Why art thou angry?
That such a slave as this should wear a sword, and have no courage, office, and no honesty. Not frost and fire hold more antipathy than I and such a knave.
Why dost thou call him knave?
His countenance likes me not.
No more, perhaps, does mine, nor his or hers.
Plain dealing is my trade, and to be plain, sir, I have seen better faces in my time than stands on any shoulders now before me.
This is some fellow that, having once been praised for bluntness, since affects a saucy rudeness. But I have known one of these surly knaves that in his plainness harboured more design than 20 cringing, complimenting minions.
What's the offence you gave him?
Never any, sir. It pleased the king, his mastery, lately, to strike me on a slender misconstruction. Whilst watching his advantage, this old lurcher tripped me behind, for which the king extolled him, and flushed with the honour of this bold exploit, drew on me here again.
Bring forth the stocks. We'll teach you.
Sir, I'm too old to learn. Call not the stocks for me. I serve the king on whose employment I was sent to you. You'll show too small respect and too bold malice against the person of my royal master, stalking his messenger.
Bring forth the stocks. As I have life and honour, there shall he sit till noon.
Till noon, my lord. Till night. And all night, too.
Why, madam, if I were your father's dog, you would not use me so.
Sir, being his knave, I will.
Let me beseech your graces to forbear him. His fault is much, and the good king, his master, will check him for it. But needs must take it ill to be thus slighted in his messenger.
We'll answer that. Our sister may receive it worse to have her gentleman assaulted. To our business lead.
Exit.
I am sorry for thee, friend. 'Tis the Duke's pleasure, whose disposition will not be controlled. But I'll entreat for thee.
Pray, do not, sir. I have watched and travelled hard. Some time I shall sleep out. The rest I'll whistle. Farewell to you, sir.
Exit Gloucester.
All weary and o'erwatched, I feel the drowsy guest steal on me. Take advantage, heavy eyes, of this kind slumber. not to behold this vile and shameful lodging.
Sleeps. Scene 4. Enter Edgar.
I heard myself proclaimed, and by the friendly hollow of a tree escaped the hunt. No port is free, no place where guards and most unusual vigilance do not attend to take me. How easy now 'twere to defeat the malice of my trail, and leave my griefs on my sword's reeking point. But love detains me from death's peaceful cell, still whispering me Cordelia's in distress. Unkind as she is, I cannot see her wretched, but must be near to wait upon her fortune. Who knows but the white minute yet may come when Edgar may do service to Cordelia? That charming hope still ties me to the oar of painful life, and makes me too submit to the humblest shifts to keep that life afoot. My face I will besmear and knit my locks. The country gives me proof and precedent of bedlam beggars, who with roaring voices strike in their numbed and mortified bare arms, pins, iron spikes, thorns, sprigs of rosemary, and thus from sheepcotes, villages and mills, sometimes with prayers, sometimes with lunatic bans, enforce their charity. Poor Turlygod, poor Tom! That's something yet. Edgar, I am no more.
Exit. Scene 5. Kent in the stocks still. Enter Lear, attended.
'Tis strange that they should so depart from home and not send back our messenger.
Hail, noble master.
How? Mak'st thou this shame thy pastime? What's he that has so much mistook thy place to set thee here?
It is both he and she, sir, your son and daughter.
No.
Yes.
No, I say.
I say yea.
By Jupiter, I swear no.
By Juno, I swear.
They durst not do't. They could not, would not do't. 'Tis worse than murder to do upon respect such violent outrage. Resolve me with all modest haste which way thou mayst deserve, or they impose this usage.
My lord, when at their home I did commend your highness letters to them, ere I was risen, arrived another post, steered in his haste, breathless and panting forth from Goneril, his mistress, salutations, whose message being delivered, they took horse, commending me to follow and attend the leisure of their answer, which I did, but meeting that other messenger, whose welcome I perceived had poisoned mine, being the very fellow that of late had shown such rudeness to your highness, I, having more man than wit about me, drew, on which he raised the house with coward cries. This was the trespass which your son and daughter thought worth the shame you see it suffer here.
Oh, how this spleen swells upward to my heart, and heaves for passage! Down, thou climbing rage, thy elements below. Where is this daughter?
Within, sir, at a mask.
Enter Gloucester.
Now, Gloucester? Ha! Deny to speak with me. They are sick, they are weary, they have travelled hard to-night. Mere fetches, bring me a better answer.
My dear lord, you know the fiery quality of the duke.
Vengeance! Death, plague, confusion! Fiery? What quality? Why, Gloucester, Gloucester! I'd speak with the Duke of Cornwall and his wife.
I have informed 'em so.
Informed 'em? Dost thou understand me, man? I tell thee, Gloucester.
Aye, my good lord.
The king would speak with Cornwall. The dear father would with his daughter speak, commands her service. Are they informed of this? My breath and blood, fiery, the fiery duke. Tell the hot duke. No, but not yet. Maybe he is not well. Infirmity does still neglect all office. I beg his pardon, and I'll chide my rashness that took the indisposed and sickly fit for the sound man. But wherefore sits he there? Death on my state, this act convinces me that this retiredness of the duke and her is plain contempt. Give me my servant forth. Go tell the Duke and's wife I'd speak with them now, instantly. Bid 'em come forth and hear me, or at their chamber door I'll beat the drum till it cry sleep to death.
Enter Cornwall and Regan.
Oh, are ye come?
Health to the king.
I am glad to see your highness.
Regan, I think you are. I know what cause I have to think so. Shouldst thou not be glad, I would divorce me from thy mother's tomb. Beloved Regan, thou wilt shake to hear what I shall utter. Thou couldst ne'er have thought it. Thy sister's naught, O Regan. She has tied ingratitude like a keen vulture here.
Kent here, set at liberty.
I scarce can speak to thee.
I pray you, sir, take patience. I have hope that you know less to value her desert than she to slack her duty.
Ha! How's that?
I cannot think my sister in the least would fail in her respects. But if perchance she has restrained the riots of your followers, 'tis on such grounds and to such wholesome ends as clears her from all blame.
My curse is on her.
Oh, sir, you are old, and should content you to be ruled and led by some discretion that discerns your state better than you yourself. Therefore, sir, return to our sister, and say you have wronged her.
Ha! Ask her forgiveness? No, no. 'Twas my mistake. Thou didst not mean so. Dear daughter, I confess that I am old. Age is unnecessary. But thou art good, and wilt dispense with my infirmity.
Good sir, no more of these unsightly passions. Return back to our sister.
Never, Regan. She has abated me of half of my train, looked black upon me, stabbed me with her tongue. All the stored vengeances of heaven fall on her ingrateful head. Strike her young bones, ye taking heirs, with lameness.
Oh, the blessed gods! Thus will you wish on me when the rash mood.
No, Regan, thou shalt never have my curse. Thy tender nature cannot give thee o'er to such impiety. Thou better know'st the offices of nature, bond of childhood, and dues of gratitude. Thou bear'st in mind the half of the kingdom which our love conferred on thee and thine.
Good sir, to the purpose.
Who put my man i' the stocks?
What trumpet's that?
I know it, my sister's. This confirms her letters. Sir, is your lady come?
Enter Goneril's gentleman.
More torture still. There is a slave whose easy borrowed pride dwells in the fickle grace of her he follows, a fashion fop that spends the day in dressing, and all to bear his lady's flattering message, that can deliver with a grace her lie, and with as bold a face bring back a greater. Out, varlet, from my sight.
What means your grace?
Who stocked my servant? Regan, I have hope thou didst not know it.
Enter Goneril.
Who comes here? Oh, heavens! If you do love old men, if your sweet sway allow obedience, if yourselves are old, make it your cause, send down and take my part. Why, Gorgon, dost thou come to haunt me here? Art not ashamed to look upon this beard? Darkness upon my eyes, they play me false. O Regan, wilt thou take her by the hand?
Why not by the hand, sir? How have I offended? All's not offence that indiscretion finds, and dotage terms so.
Heart, thou art too tough.
I pray you, sir, being old, confess you are so. If till the expiration of your month you will return and sojourn with my sister, dismissing half your train, come then to me. I am now from home, and out of that provision that shall be needful for your entertainment.
Return with her, and 50 nights dismissed? No, rather I'll forswear all roofs, and choose to be companion to the midnight wolf.
my naked head exposed to the merciless air, than have my smallest wants supplied by her.
At your choice, sir.
Now, I prithee, daughter, do not make me mad. I will not trouble thee, my child. Farewell. We'll meet no more, no more see one another. Let shame come when it will. I do not call it. I do not bid the thunder-bearer strike, nor tell tales of thee to avenging heaven. Mend when thou canst. Be better at thy leisure. I can be patient. I can stay with Regan. I and my 100 knights.
Your pardon, sir. I looked not for you yet, nor am provided for your fit welcome.
Is this well spoken now?
My sister treats you fair. What, 50 followers? Is it not well? What should you need of more?
Why might not you, my lord, receive attendance from those whom she calls servants, or from mine?
Why not, my lord? If then they chance to slack you, we could control them. If you come to me, for now I see the danger, I entreat you to bring but 25. To no more will I give place.
Hold now my temper. Stand this bolt unmoved, and I am thunderproof. The wicked, when compared with the more wicked, seem beautiful, and not to be the worst, stands in some rank of praise. Now, Goneril, thou art innocent again. I'll go with thee. Thy 50 yet does double 25, and thou art twice her love.
Hear me, my lord. What need you 25, 10, or 5, to follow in a house where twice so many have a command to attend you?
What need one?
Blood, fire! Here leprosies and bluest plagues. Room, room for hell to belch her horrors up, and drench the Circes in a stream of fire. Hark how the infernals echo to my rage their whips and snakes.
How lewd a thing is passion!
So old and stomachful.
Lightning and thunder.
Heavens, drop your patience down. You see me here, ye gods, a poor old man, as full of griefs as age, wretched in both. I'll bear no more. No, you unnatural hags! I will have such revenges on you both that all the world shall. I will do such things, what they are yet I know not, but they shall be the terrors of the earth. You think I'll weep?
Thunder again.
This heart shall break into a 1,000 pieces before I'll weep. Oh, gods, I shall go mad.
Exit.
'Tis a wild night. Come out of the storm.
Exeunt. End of the second act. Act 3 of The History of King Lear by Nahum Tate. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Act 3. Scene: A Desert Heath. Scene 1. Enter Lear and Kent in the storm.
Blow, winds, and burst your cheeks! Rage louder yet! Fantastic lightning, singe my white head! Spout cataracts and hurricanoes, fall till you have drowned the towns and palaces of proud, ingrateful man.
Not all my best entreaties can persuade him into some needful shelter, or to bide this poor slight covering on his aged head, exposed to this wild war of earth and heaven.
Rumble thy fill! Fight, whirlwind, rain, and fire! Not fire, wind, rain, or thunder are my daughters. I tax not you, ye elements, with unkindness. I never gave you kingdoms, called you children.
You owe me no obedience. Then let fall your horrible pleasure. Here I stand, your slave, a poor, infirm, weak, and despised old man. Yet I will call you servile ministers that have with two pernicious daughters joined their high-engendered battle against a head so old and white as mine. Oh, oh, 'tis foul!
Hard by, sir, is a hovel that will lend some shelter from this tempest.
I will forget my nature, what? So kind a father I, there's the point.
Consider, good my liege, things that love night love not such nights as this. These wrathful skies frighten the very wanderers of the dark and make them keep their caves. Such drenching rain, such sheets of fire, such claps of horrid thunder, such groans of roaring winds have ne'er been known.
Let the great gods that keep this dreadful putter o'er our heads find out their enemies now. Tremble, thou wretch, that hast within thee undiscovered crimes. Hide, thou bloody hand, thou perjured villain, holy, holy hypocrite, that drink'st the widow's tears. Sigh now, and cry these dreadful summoner's grace. I am a man more sinned against than sinning.
Good sir, to the hovel.
My wit begins to burn. Come on, my boy. How dost, my boy? Art cold? I'm cold myself. Show me this straw, my fellow. The art of our necessity is strange, and can make vile things precious. My poor knave.
Louder, storm.
Cold as I am at heart, I've one place there that's sorry yet for thee.
Exit. Scene 2. Gloucester's Palace. Enter Bastard.
The storm is in our louder revelings drowned. Thus would I reign, could I but mount a throne. The riots of these proud imperial sisters already have imposed the galling yoke of taxes, and hard impositions on the drudging peasant's neck, who bellow out their loud complaints in vain. Triumphant queens, with what assurance do they tread the crowd? Oh, for a taste of such majestic beauty, which none but my hot veins are fit to engage. Nor are my wishes desperate, for even now, during the banquet, I observed their glances shot thick at me, and as they left the room, each cast by stealth a kind, inviting smile. The happy earnest. Ha! Huh?
Two servants, from several entrances, deliver him each a letter and exit. Reads.
Where merit is not so transparent, not to behold it were blindness, and not to reward it ingratitude. Goneril. Enough. Blind and ingrateful should I be not to obey the summons of this oracle. Now for a second letter.
Opens the other.
If modesty be not your enemy, doubt not to find me your friend. Regan. Excellent Sibyl! Oh, my glowing blood! I am already sick of expectation and pant for the possession. Here Gloucester comes with business on his brow. Be hushed, my joys.
I come to seek thee, Edmund, to impart a business of importance. I knew thy loyal heart is touched to see the cruelty of these ingrateful daughters against our royal master.
Most savage and unnatural.
This change in the state sits uneasy. The commons repine aloud at their female tyrants. Already they cry out for the reinstallment of their good old king, whose injuries, I fear, will inflame them into mutiny.
'Tis to be hoped, not feared.
Thou hast it, boy. 'Tis to be hoped, indeed. On me they cast their eyes, and hourly court me to lead em on. and whilst this head is mine, I am theirs. A little covert craft, my boy, and then for open action. 'Twill be employment worthy such honest, daring souls as thine. Thou, Edmund, art my trusty emissary. Haste on the spur at the first break of day with these dispatches to the Duke of Cambrai.
Gives him letters.
You know what mortal feuds have always flamed between this Duke of Cornwall's family and his full 20,000 mountainers the inveterate prince will send to our assistance. Dispatch, commend us to his grace, and prosper.
Aside.
Yes, credulous old man, I will commend you to his grace the Duke of Cornwall. Instantly to show him these contents in thine own character, and sealed with thy own signet. Then forthwith the choleric duke gives sentence on thy life, and to my hand thy vast revenues fall to glut my pleasure that till now has starved.
Gloucester going off, is met by Cordelia entering, Bastard observing at a distance.
Turn, Gloucester, turn, by all the sacred powers. I do conjure you give my griefs a hearing. You must, you shall, nay, I am sure you will, for you were always still the just and good.
What wouldst thou, princess? Rise and speak thy griefs.
Nay, you shall promise to redress them too, or here I'll kneel for ever. I entreat thy succour for a father and a king, an injured father and an injured king.
O charming sorrow! How her tears adorn her like dew on flowers! But she is virtuous, and I must quench this hopeless fire in the kindling.
Consider, princess, for whom thou begg'st. 'Tis for the king that wronged thee.
Oh, name not that. He did not, could not wrong me. Nay, muse not, Gloucester, for it is too likely. This injured king, ere this is past your aid, and gone distracted with his savage wrongs.
I'll gaze no more. And yet my eyes are charmed.
Or what if it be worse? Can there be worse? As 'tis too probable this furious night has pierced his tender body, the bleak winds and cold rain chilled, or lightning struck him dead. If it be so, your promise is discharged, and I have only one poor boon to beg. That you'd convey me to his breathless trunk, with my torn robes to wrap his hoary head, with my torn hair to bind his hands and feet, then with a shower of tears to wash his clay-smeared cheeks, and die beside him.
Rise, fair Cordelia, thou hast piety enough to atone for both thy sister's crimes. I have already plotted to restore my injured master, and thy virtue tells me we shall succeed, and suddenly.
Exit.
Dispatch, Arant, provide me a disguise. We'll instantly go seek the king, and bring him some relief.
How, madam, are you ignorant of what your impious sisters have decreed? Immediate death for any that relieve him.
I cannot dread the Furies in this case.
In such a night as this, consider, madam, for many miles about there's scarce a bush to shelter in.
Therefore no shelter for the king, and more our charity to find him out. What have not women dared for vicious love, and will be shining proofs that they can dare, for piety as much. Blow winds and lightnings fall, bold in my virgin innocence I'll fly, my royal father to relieve, or die.
Exit.
Provide me a disguise, we'll instantly go seek the king. A lucky change, that virtue which I feared would be my hindrance has proved the bond to my design. I'll bribe two ruffians that shall at a distance follow, and seize him in some desert place, and there, whilst one retains her, t'other shall return to inform me where she's lodged. I'll be disguised too. Whilst they are poaching for me, I'll to the Duke with these dispatches, then to the field where, like the vigorous Jove, I will enjoy this semele in a storm. It will deaf her cries like drums in battle, lest her groans should pierce my pitying ear and make the amorous fight less fierce.
Exit. Scene 3. Storm still. The field scene. Enter Lear and Kent.
Here is the place, my lord. Good my lord, enter. The tyranny of this open night's too rough for nature to endure.
Let me alone.
Good my lord, enter.
Wilt break my heart?
Beseech you, sir.
Thou think'st 'tis much that this contentious storm invades us to the skin? So 'tis to thee. But where the greater malady is fixed, the lesser is scarce felt. The tempest in my mind does from my senses take all feeling else, save what beats there, filial ingratitude. Is it not as this mouth should tear this hand for lifting food to't? But I'll punish home. No, I will weep no more. In such a night to shut me out, pour on. I will endure in such a night as this. Oh, Regan, Goneril, your kind old father, whose frank heart gave all. Oh, that way madness lies. Let me shun that, no more of that.
See, my lord, here's the entrance.
Well, I'll go in, and pass it all. I'll pray, and then I'll sleep. Poor naked wretches, wherefore e'er you are, that bide the pelting of this pitiless storm, how shall your houseless heads and unfed sides sustain this shock? Your raggedness defend you from seasons such as these. Oh, I have ta'en too little care of this. Take physic, pomp. Expose thyself to feel what wretches feel, that thou mayst cast the superflux to them, and show the heavens more just.
Edgar in the hovel.
5 fathom and a half, poor Tom.
What art thou that dost grumble there i' the straw? Come forth.
Away! The foul fiend follows me. Through the sharp hawthorn blows the cold wind. Mom, go to thy bed and warm thee. Ah, what do I see? By all my griefs the poor old king beheaded, and drenched in this foul storm, professing serene. Are all your protestations come to this?
Tell me, fellow, didst thou give all to thy daughters?
Who gives anything to poor Tom, whom the foul fiend has led through fire and through flame, through bushes and bogs, that has laid knives under his pillow and halters in his pew, that has made him proud of heart to ride in a bay-trotting horse over 4-inched bridges, to course his own shadow for a traitor? Bless thy 5 wits, Tom's a-cold.
Shivers.
Bless thee from whirlwinds, star-blasting and taking. Do poor Tom some charity, whom the foul fiend vexes. Sir, sir, there I could have him now, and there again.
Have his daughters brought him to this pass? Couldst thou save nothing? Didst thou give em all?
He has no daughters, sir.
Death, traitor! Nothing could have subdued nature to such a lowness but his unkind daughters.
Pillicock sat upon Pillicock Hill. Hello, hello, hello!
Is it the fashion that discarded fathers should have such little mercy on their flesh? Ludicrous punishment! 'Twas this flesh begot those pelican daughters.
Take heed of the foul fiend. Obey thy parents. Keep thy word justly. Swear not. Commit not with man's sworn spouse. Set not thy sweetheart on proud array. Tom's a-cold.
What hast thou been?
A serving man proud of heart, that curled my hair, used perfume and washes, that served the lust of my mistress's heart, and did the act of darkness with her. Swore as many oaths as I spoke words, and broke them all in the sweet face of heaven. Let not the paint, nor the patch, nor the rushing of silks betray thy poor heart to woman. Keep thy foot out of brothels, thy hand out of plackets, thy pen from creditors' books, and defy the foul fiend. Still through the hawthorn blows the cold wind. Sss!
Some mon nonny dolphin, my boy, whist! The boy, sissy! Soft, let him trot by.
Death, thou wert better in thy grave than thus to answer with thy uncovered body this extremity of the sky. And yet consider him well, and man's no more than this. Thou art indebted to the worm for no silk, to the beast for no hide, to the cat for no perfume. Ha! Here's two of us are sophisticated. Thou art the thing itself. Unaccommodated man is no more than such a poor, bare, forked animal as thou art. Off, off, ye vain disguises, empty lendings. I'll be my original self. Quick, quick, uncase me.
Defend his wits, good heaven.
One point I had forgot. What's your name?
Poor Tom that eats the swimming frog, the walnut, and the waternut, that in the fury of his heart, when the foul fiend rages, eats cow dung for salads, swallows the old rat and the ditch dog, that drinks the green mantle of the standing pool that's whipped from tithing to tithing, that has three suits to his back, six shirts to his body, horse to ride and weapon to wear, but rats and mice and such small deer have been Tom's food for 7 long year. Beware, my follower, peace, Smulkin, peace, thou foul fiend.
One word more, but be sure, true counsel. Tell me, is a madman a gentleman or a yeoman?
I feared 'twould come to this. His wits are gone.
Frateretto calls me and tells me Nero is an angler in the lake of darkness. Pray, innocent, and beware the foul fiend.
Right. Was it not pleasant to have 1,000 with red-hot spits come hissing in upon em?
My tears begin to take his part so much, they mar my counterfeiting.
The little dogs and all, Tray, Blanche, and Sweetheart, see they bark at me.
Tom will throw his head at them, avaunt ye curs. Be thy mouth or black or white, tooth that poisons if it bite, mastiff, greyhound, mongrel, grim, hound or spaniel, broch or him, bobtail, tight or trundle-tail, Tom will make him weep and wail, for with throwing thus my head, dogs leap the hatch, and all are fled. Ooh, dee, 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 see, see, see! Come march to wakes and fairs and market-towns. Poor Tom, thy horn is dry.
You, sir, I entertain you for 1 of my 100. Only I do not like the fashion of your garments. You'll say they're Persian, but no matter. Let 'em be changed.
Enter Gloucester.
This is the foul flibbertigibbet. He begins at curfew and walks at first cock. He gives the web and the pin, knits the elf lock, squints the eye and makes the hare lip, mildews the white wheat and hurts the poor creature of the earth. Swithin footed thrice the cold, he met the nightmare and her ninefold. 'Twas there he did appoint her. He bid her alight and her troth plight, and aroint the witch aroint her.
What, has your grace no better company?
The Prince of Darkness is the gentleman. Modo he is called, and Mahu.
Go with me, sir. Hard by I have a tenant. My duty cannot suffer me to obey in all your daughter's hard commands, who have enjoined me to make fast my doors, and let this tyrannous night take hold upon you. Yet have I ventured to come seek you out, and bring you where both fire and food is ready.
Good my lord, take his offer.
First let me talk with this philosopher. Say, Stagirite, what is the cause of thunder?
Beseech you, sir, go with me.
I'll talk a word with this same learned Theban. What is your study?
How to prevent the fiend and to kill vermin.
Let me ask you a word in private.
His wits are quite unsettled. Good sir, let's force him hence.
Canst blame him? His daughters seek his death. This bedlam but disturbs him the more. Fellow, be gone.
child Roland to the dark tower came. His word was still fee-fo-fum. I smell the blood of a British man. Oh, torture!
Exit.
Now, I prithee, friend, let's take him in our arms and carry him where he shall meet both welcome and protection. Good sir, along with us.
You say right. Let him anatomize Regan, see what breeds about her heart. Is there any cause in nature for these hard hearts?
Beseech your grace.
St! Make no noise, make no noise. So, so. We'll to supper i' the morning.
Exeunt. Scene 4. Enter Cordelia and Arante.
Dear madam, rest ye here. Our search is vain. Look, here's a shed. Beseech ye, enter here.
Prithee, go in thyself. Seek thy own ease, where the mind's free, the body's delicate. This tempest but diverts me from the thought of what would hurt me more.
Enter two ruffians.
We have dodged him far enough. This place is private. I'll keep him prisoners here within this hovel, whilst you return and bring Lord Edmund hither. But help me first to house them.
Nothing but this, dear devil,
shows gold,
should have drawn me through all this tempest. But to our work.
They seized Cordelia and Arante, who shriek out.
Soft, madame, we are friends. Dispatch, I say.
Help, murder, help! Gods, some kind thunderbolt to strike me dead.
Enter Edgar.
What cry was that? Ha, women seized by ruffians. Is this a place and time for villainy? Avaunt, ye bloodhounds!
Drives them with his quarter-staff.
The devil!
They run off.
Oh, speak! What are ye that appear to be o' the tender sex, and yet unguarded wander through the dead mazes of this dreadful night, where though at full the clouded moon scarce darts imperfect glimmerings?
First, say what art thou, our guardian angel, that wert pleased to assume that horrid shape to fright the ravishers? We'll kneel to thee.
O my tumultuous blood! By all my trembling veins, Cordelia's voice! 'Tis she herself! My senses sure conform to my wild garb, and I am mad indeed.
Whate'er thou art, befriend a wretched virgin, and if thou canst direct our weary search.
Who relieves poor Tom, that sleeps on the nettle, with the hedge pig for his pillow, while smug plied the bellows she trucked with her fellows? The freckle-fact mob was a blows and a drab, yet Swithin made Oberon jealous. Oh, torture!
Alack, madam, a poor wandering lunatic!
And yet his language seemed but now well-tempered. Speak, friend, to one more wretched than thyself, and if thou hast one interval of sense, inform us if thou canst where we may find a poor old man who through his health has strayed the tedious night. Speak, sawst thou such a one?
Aside.
The king her father, whom she's come to seek through all the terrors of this night, O gods, that such amazing piety, such tenderness, should yet to me be cruel. Yes, fair one, such a one was lately here, and is conveyed by some that came to seek him, to a neighbouring cottage, but distinctly where I know not.
Blessings on him. Let's find him out, Arant, for thou seest we are in heaven's protection.
Going off.
O Cordelia!
Ha! Thou know'st my name.
As you did once know Edgar's.
Edgar!
The poor remains of Edgar. What your scorn has left him.
Do we wake, Arant?
My father seeks my life, which I preserved in hopes of some blessed minute to oblige distressed Cordelia, and the gods have given it. That thought alone prevailed with me to take this frantic dress, to make the earth my bed, with these bare limbs all change of seasons bide, noon's scorching heat and midnight's piercing cold, to feed on offals and to drink with herds, to combat with the winds and be the sport of clowns, or what's more wretched yet, their pity.
Was ever tale so full of misery?
But such a fall as this, I grant, was due to my aspiring love, for 'twas presumptuous, though not presumptuously pursued. For well you know I wore my flames concealed, and silent as the lamps that burn in tombs, till you perceived my grief, with modest grace drew forth the secret, and then sealed my pardon.
You had your pardon, nor can you challenge more.
What do I challenge more? Such vanity agrees not with these rags. But in my prosperous state, rich Gloucester's heir, you silenced my pretences, and enjoined me to trouble you upon that theme no more. Then what reception must love's language find from these bare limbs and beggar's humble weeds?
Such as the voice of pardon to a wretch condemned, such as the shouts of succouring forces to a town besieged.
Ah, what new method now of cruelty?
Come to my arms, thou dearest, best of men, and take the kindest vows that e'er were spoke by a protesting maid.
Is it possible?
By the dear vital stream that baths my heart, these hallowed rags of thine and naked virtue, these abject tassels, these fantastic shreds, ridiculous even to the meanest clown, to me are dearer than the richest pomp of purple monarchs.
Generous, charming maid, the gods alone that made can rate thy worth. This most amazing excellence shall be fame's triumph in succeeding ages, when thy bright example shall adorn the scene and teach the world perfection.
Cold and weary, we'll rest awhile, Arant, on that straw, then forward to find out the poor old king.
Look, I have flint and steel, the implements of wandering lunatics. I'll strike a light, and make a fire beneath this shed to dry thy storm-drenched garments, ere thou lie to rest thee. Then fierce and wakeful as Tesperian dragon, I'll watch beside thee to protect thy sleep. Meanwhile the stars shall dart their kindest beams, and angels visit my Cordelia's dreams.
Exeunt. Scene 5. Scene The Palace. Enter Cornwall, Regan, Bastard, Servants. Cornwall with Gloucester's letters.
I will have my revenge ere I depart his house. Regan, see here a plot upon our state. 'Tis Gloucester's character that has betrayed his double trust of subject and of host.
Then double be our vengeance. This confirms the intelligence that we now received, that he has been this night to seek the king. But who, sir, was the kind discoverer?
Our eagle, quick to spy and fierce to seize, our trusty Edmund.
'Twas a noble service. O Cornwall, take him to thy deepest trust, and wear him as a jewel at thy heart.
Think, sir, how hard a fortune I sustain, that makes me thus repent of serving you.
Weeps.
Oh, that this treason had not been, or I not the discoverer.
Edmund, thou shalt find a father in our love, and from this minute we call thee Earl of Gloucester. But there yet remains another justice to be done, and that's to punish this discarded traitor. But lest thy tender nature should relent at his just sufferings, nor brook the sight, we wish thee to withdraw.
To Edmund aside.
The grotto, sir, within the lower grove has privacy to suit a mourner's thought.
And there I may expect a comforter. Ha, madam!
What may happen, sir, I know not, but 'twas a friend's advice.
Exit Bastard.
Bring in the traitor.
Gloucester brought in.
Bind fast his arms.
Oh, what mean your graces? You are my guests. Pray do me no foul play.
Bind him, I say, hard, harder yet.
Now, traitor, thou shalt find.
Speak, rebel, where hast thou sent the king, whom, spite of our decree, thou sawst last night?
I'm tied to the stake, and I must stand the course.
Say where and why thou hast concealed him.
Oh, because I would not see thy cruel hands tear out his poor old eyes, nor thy fierce sister carve his anointed flesh. But I shall see the swift winged vengeance overtake such children.
See it shalt thou never. Slaves, perform your work. Out with those treacherous eyes. Dispatch, I say, if thou seest vengeance.
Oh, he that will think to live till he be old, give me some help. Oh, cruel! Oh, ye gods!
They put out his eyes.
Hold, hold, my lord, I bar your cruelty. I cannot love your safety and give way to such a barbarous practice.
Ha, my villain!
I have been your servant from my infancy, but better service have I never done you than with this boldness.
Take thy death, slave!
Nay, then revenge whilst yet my blood is warm.
Fight.
Help here. Are you not hurt, my lord?
Edmund, enkindle all the sparks of nature to quit this horrid act.
Out, treacherous villain! Thou call'st on him that hates thee. It was he that broached thy treason, shewed us thy dispatches. There, read and save the Cambrian prince a labour. If thy eyes fail thee, call for spectacles.
Oh, my folly! Then Edgar was abused. Kind gods, forgive me that.
How is't, my lord?
Turn out that eyeless villain. Let him smell his way to Cambrai. Throw this slave upon a dunghill. Regan, I bleed apace. Give me your arm.
Exeunt.
Oh, all dark and comfortless! Where are those various objects that but now employed my busy eyes? Where those eyes? Dead are their piercing rays that lately shot o'er flowery vales to distant sunny hills, and drew with joy the vast horizon in. These groping hands are now my only guides, and feeling all my sight. O misery! What words can sound my grief? Shut from the living whilst among the living, dark as the grave amidst the bustling world, at once from business and from pleasure barred, no more to view the beauty of the spring, nor see the face of kindred or of friend. Yet still one way the extremest fate affords, and even the blind can find the way to death. Must I then tamely die, and unrevenged, so Lear may fall? No, with these bleeding rings I will present me to the pitying crowd, and with the rhetoric of these dropping veins enflame them to revenge their king and me. Then, when the glorious mischief is on wing, this lumber from some precipice I'll throw, and dash it on the ragged flint below, whence my freed soul to her bright sphere shall fly, through boundless orbs eternal regions spy, and like the sun be all one glorious aye.
Exit. End of the third act. Act 4 of The History of King Lear by Nahum Tate. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Act 4, Scene 1. A Grotto. Edmund and Regan amorously seated, listening to music.
Why were those beauties made another's right which none can prize like me? Charming queen, take all my blooming youth. Forever fold me in those soft arms. Lull me in endless sleep that I may dream of pleasures too transporting for life to bear.
Live, live, my Gloucester, and feel no death but that of swooning joy. I yield thee blisses on no harder terms than that thou continue to be happy.
This jealousy is yet more kind. Is't possible that I should wander from a paradise to feed on sickly weeds? Such sweets live here that constancy will be no virtue in me.
Aside.
And yet must I forthwith go to meet her sister, to whom I must protest as much. Suppose it be the same. Why, best of all, and I have then my lesson ready conned.
Wear this remembrance of me. I dare now.
Gives him a ring.
Absent myself no longer from the Duke, whose wound grows dangerous, I hope mortal.
And let this happy image of your Gloucester,
pulling out a picture, drops a note,
lodge in that breast where all his treasure lies.
Exit.
To this brave youth a woman's blooming beauties are due. My fool usurps my bed. What's here? Confusion on my eyes.
Reads.
Where merit is so transparent, not to behold it were blindness, and not to reward it ingratitude. Goneril. Vexatious accident! Yet fortunate, too. My jealousy's confirmed, and I am taught to cast for my defence.
Enter an officer.
Now, what mean those shouts, and what thy hasty entrance?
A most surprising and a sudden change. The peasants are all up in mutiny, and only want a chief to lead em on to storm your palace.
On what provocation?
At last day's public festival, to which the yeomen from all quarters had repaired, old Gloucester, whom you late deprived of sight, his veins yet streaming fresh, presents himself, proclaims your cruelty and their oppression, with the king's injuries, which so enraged them, that now that mutiny, which long had crept, takes wing and threatens your best powers.
White-livered slave, our forces raised and led by valiant Edmund shall drive this monster of rebellion back to her dark cell. Young Gloucester's arm allays the storm his father's feeble breath did raise.
Exit. Scene 2. The Field. Scene. Enter Edgar.
The lowest and most abject thing of fortune, stand still in hope, and is secure from fear. The lamentable change is from the best. The worst returns to better. Who comes here?
Enter Gloucester, led by an old man.
My father poorly led, deprived of sight, the precious stones torn from their bleeding rings. Something I heard of this inhumane deed, but disbelieved it, as an act too horrid for the hot hell of a cursed woman's fury. When will the measure of my woes be full?
Revenge! Thou art afoot. Success attend thee. Well have I sold my eyes, if the event prove happy for the injured king.
Oh, my good lord, I have been your tenant, and your father's tenant, these fourscore years.
Away, get thee away, good friend, be gone. Thy comforts can do me no good at all. Thee they may hurt.
You cannot see your way.
I have no way, and therefore want no eyes.
I stumbled when I saw. Oh, dear son Edgar, the food of thy abused father's wrath! Might I but live to see thee in my touch, I'd say I had eyes again.
Alas, he's sensible that I was wronged, and should I own myself, his tender heart would break betwixt the extremes of grief and joy.
Oh, no! Who's there?
A charity for poor Tom. Play fair and defy the foul fiend. O gods, and must I still pursue this trade?
Aside.
Trifling beneath such loads of misery.
'Tis poor Mad Tom.
In the late storm I such a fellow saw, which made me think a man a worm. Where is the lunatic?
Here, my lord.
Get thee now away. If for my sake thou wilt or take us hence a mile or two in the way toward Dover, do it for ancient love, and bring me some covering for this naked wretch, whom I'll entreat to lead me.
Alack, my lord, he's mad.
Oh, 'tis the time's plague when madmen lead the blind. Do as I bid thee.
I'll bring him the best peril that I have, come on't what will.
Exit.
Sirrah, naked fellow.
Poor Tom's a-cold. I cannot fool it longer, and yet I must. Bless thy sweet eyes, they bleed. Believed poor Tom even weeps his blind to see them.
Know'st thou the way to Dover?
Both stile and gate, horseway and footpath. Poor Tom has been scared out of his good wits. Bless every true man's son from the foul fiend.
Here, take this purse. That I am wretched makes thee the happier. Heaven deal so still. Thus let the griping usurer's hoard be scattered. So distribution shall undo excess, and each man have enough. Dost thou know Dover?
Aye, master.
There is a cliff whose high and bending head looks dreadfully down on the roaring deep. Bring me but to the very brink of it, and I'll repair the poverty thou bearest with something rich about me. From that place I shall no leading need.
Give me thy arm. Poor Tom shall guide thee.
Soft, for I hear the tread of passengers.
Enter Kent and Cordelia.
Ah me! Your fear's too true. It was the king. I spoke but now with some that met him, as mad as the vexed sea, singing aloud, crowned with rank femeder and furrow weeds, with berries, burdocks, violets, daisies, poppies, and all the idle flowers that grow in our sustaining corn. Conduct me to him, to prove my last endeavours to restore him, and heaven so prosper thee.
I will, good lady. Ha, Gloucester here. Turn, poor dark man, and hear a friend's condolement, who at sight of thine forgets his own distress, thy old true Kent.
How, Kent? From whence returned?
I have not since my banishment been absent, but in disguise followed the abandoned king. 'Twas me thou sawst with him in the late storm.
Oh, let me embrace thee. Had I eyes, I now should weep for joy. But let this trickling blood suffice instead of tears.
O misery! To whom shall I complain, or in what language? Forgive, O wretched man, the piety that brought thee to this pass. 'Twas I that caused it. I cast me at thy feet and beg of thee to crush these weeping eyes to equal darkness, if that will give thee any recompense.
Aside.
Was ever season so distressed as this?
I think Cordelia's voice. Rise, pious princess, and take a dark man's blessing.
Oh, my Edgar, my virtue's now grown guilty, works the bane of those that do befriend me. Heaven forsakes me, and when you look that way, it is but just that you should hate me too.
Oh, waive this cutting speech, and spare to wound a heart that's on the rack.
No longer cloud thee, Kent, in that disguise. There's business for thee, and of noblest weight. Our injured country is at length in arms, urged by the king's inhuman wrongs and mine, and only want a chief to lead 'em on. That task be thine.
Aside.
Brave Britons, then there's life and yet.
Then have we one cast for our fortune yet. Come, princess, I'll bestow you with the king. Then on the spur to head these forces. Farewell, good Gloucester, to our conduct trust.
And be your cause as prosperous as 'tis just.
Exeunt. Scene 3. Goneril's Palace. Enter Goneril, attendants.
It was great ignorance, Gloucester's eyes being out, to let him live. Where he arrives, he moves all hearts against us. Edmund, I think, is gone in pity to his misery to dispatch him.
No, madam, he's returned on speedy summons, back to your sister.
Ha! I like not that. Such speed must have the wings of love. Where's Albany?
Madam, within, but never man so changed. I told him of the uproar of the peasants. He smiled at it when I informed him of Gloucester's treason.
Trouble him no further. It is his coward spirit. Back to our sister, hasten her musters, and let her know I have given the distaff into my husband's hands. That done, with special care deliver these dispatches in private to young Gloucester.
Enter a messenger.
O madam, most unreasonable news. The Duke of Cornwall's dead of his late wound, whose loss your sister has in part supplied, making brave Edmund general of her forces.
One way, I like this well. But being widow and my Gloucester with her, may blast the promised harvest of our love. A word more, sir. Add speed to your journey. And if you chance to meet with that blind traitor, preferment falls on him that cuts him off.
Exeunt. Scene 4. Field Scene. Gloucester and Edgar.
When shall we come to the top of that same hill?
We climb it now. Mark how we labour.
Methinks the ground is even.
Horrible steep. Hark, do you hear the sea?
No, truly.
Why, then your other senses grow imperfect by your eyes' anguish.
So may it be indeed. Methinks thy voice is altered, and thou speak'st in better phrase and matter than thou didst.
You are much deceived. In nothing am I altered, but in my garments.
Methinks you're better spoken.
Come on, sir, here's the place. How fearful and dizzy 'tis to cast one's eyes so low. The crows and coughs that wing the midway air show scarce so big as beetles. Halfway down hangs one that gathers samphire, dreadful trade. The fishermen that walk upon the beach appear like mice, and yon tall anchoring bark seems lessened to her cock a boy almost too small for sight. The murmuring surge cannot be heard so high. I look no more, lest my brain turn, and the disorder make me tumble down headlong.
Set me where you stand.
You are now within a foot of the extreme verge. For all beneath the moon, I would not now leap forward.
Let go my hand. Here, friend, is another purse. In it a jewel well worth a poor man's taking. Get thee further. Bid me farewell, and let me hear thee going.
Fare you well, sir, that I do trifle thus with this his despair. is but designed to cure it.
Thus, mighty gods, this world I do renounce, and in your sight shake my afflictions off. If I could bear 'em longer, and not fall to quarrel with your great opposeless wills, my snuff and feebler part of nature should burn itself out. If Edgar live, oh, bless him! Now, fellow, fare thee well.
Gone, sir. Farewell. And yet I know not how conceit may rob the treasury of life. Had it been where he thought, by this had thought been passed. Alive or dead? Ho, sir, friend, hear you, sir, speak. Thus might he pass indeed, yet he revives. What are you, sir?
Away, and let me die.
Hadst thou been aught but gossamer feathers air, falling so many fathom down, thou hadst shivered like an egg. But thou dost breathe, hast heavy substance, bleeds not, speak'st, art sound, thy lives a miracle.
But have I fallen or no?
From the dread summit of this chalky bourne, look up an height. The shrill-tuned lark so high cannot be seen or heard. Do but look up.
Alack, I have no eyes. Is wretchedness deprived that benefit to end itself by death?
Give me your arm. Up so, how is't? Feel you your legs? You stand?
Oh, too well, too well.
Upon the crow of the cliff, what thing was that which parted from you?
A poor, unfortunate beggar.
As I stood here below, methought his eyes were two full moons, wide nostrils breathing fire. It was some fiend. Therefore, thou happy father, think that the all-powerful gods who make them honours of men's impossibilities have preserved thee.
Oh, 'tis wonderful. Henceforth I'll bear affliction till it expire. The goblin which you speak of, I took it for a man. Oft times 'twould say, the fiend, the fiend. He led me to that place.
Bear free and patient thoughts. But who comes here?
Enter Lear, a coronet of flowers on his head, wreaths and garlands about him.
No, no, they cannot touch me for coining. I am the king himself.
Oh, piercing sight!
Nature's above art in that respect. There's your press money. That fellow handles his bow like a cow-keeper. Draw me a clothier's yard. A mouse, a mouse! Peace, ho! There's my gauntlet. I'll prove it on a giant. Bring up the brown bills. Oh, well flown, bird. I' the white, phew! Give the word.
Sweet marjoram.
Pass.
I know that voice.
Ha! Goneril with a white beard. They flattered me like a dog, and told me I had white hairs on my chin before the black ones were there. To say aye and no to everything that I said, aye and no, too, was no good divinity. When the rain came once to wet me, and the winds to make me chatter, when the thunder would not peace at my bidding, there I found 'em, there I smelt 'em out. Go to, they are not men of their words. They told me I was a king. 'Tis a lie. I am not argue proof.
That voice I well remember. Is't not the king's?
Aye, every inch a king. When I do stare, see how the subject quakes. I pardon that man's life. What was the cause? Adultery? Thou shalt not die. Die for adultery? The wren goes toot, and the small gilded fly engenders in my sight. Let copulation thrive. For Gloucester's bastard son was kinder to his father than were my daughters got i' the lawful bed. Toot, luxury, pell-mell, for I lack soldiers.
Oh, not all my sorrows past so deep have touched me as these sad accents. Sight were now a torment.
Behold that simpering lady, she that starts at pleasure's name, and thinks her ear profaned with the least wanton word. Would you believe it? The fitcher nor the pampered steed goes to it with such a riotous appetite. Down from the waist they are centaurs, though women all above. But to the girdle do the gods inherit. Beneath is all the fiends. There's hell, there's darkness, the sulphurous unfathomed.
Fie, fie, pah!
An ounce of civet, good apothecary, to sweeten my imagination. There's money for thee.
Let me kiss that hand.
Let me wipe it first. It smells of mortality.
Speak, sir. Do you know me?
I remember thy eyes well enough. Nay, do thy worst, blind Cupid. I'll not love. Read me this challenge. Mark but the penning of it.
Were all the letters suns, I could not see.
I would not take this from report. Wretched Cordelia, what will thy virtue do when thou shalt find this fresh affliction added to the tale of thy unparalleled griefs?
Read.
What with this case of eyes?
Oho, are you there with me? No eyes in your head, and no money in your purse. Yet you see how this world goes.
I see it feelingly.
What, art mad? A man may see how this world goes with no eyes. Look with thy ears. See how yon justice rails on that simple thief. Shake 'em together, and the first that drops, be it thief or justice, is a villain. Thou hast seen a farmer's dog bark at a beggar?
Ay, sir.
And the man run from the cur? There thou mightst behold the great image of authority, a dog's obeyed in office. Thou rascal beadle, hold thy bloody hand. Why dost thou lash that strumpet? Thou hotly lustest to enjoy her in that kind for which thou whipp'st her. Do, do, the judge that sentenced her has been beforehand with thee.
Oh, how stiff is my vile sense that yields not yet.
I tell thee the usurer hangs the cozener. Through tattered robes small vices do appear. Robes and fur gowns hide all. Place sins with gold. Why, there 'tis for thee, my friend. Make much of it. It has the power to seal the accuser's lips. Get thee glass eyes, and like a scurvy politician, seem to see the things thou dost not. Pull, pull off my boots. Hard. Harder. So. So.
Oh, matter and impertinency mixed. Reason in madness.
If thou wilt weep my fortunes, take my eyes. I know thee well enough. Thy name is Gloucester. Thou must be patient. We came crying hither. Thou knowest the first time that we taste the air, we wail and cry. I'll preach to thee, mark.
Break, laboring heart.
When we are born, we cry that we are come to this great stage of fools.
Enter two or three gentlemen.
Oh, Herius, lay hand upon him, sir. Your dearest daughter sends.
No rescue? What, a prisoner? I am even the natural fool of fortune. Use me well, you shall have ransom. Let me have surgeons. Oh, I am cut to the brains.
You shall have anything.
No seconds? All myself? I will die bravely, like a smug bridegroom,
flushed and pampered as a priest's whore. I am a king, my masters, know ye that?
You are a royal one, and we obey you.
It were an excellent stratagem to shoe a troop of horse with felt.
I'll put in proof. No noise, no noise.
Now will we steal upon these sons-in-law?
And then kill, 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 kill.
Exit running.
A sight most moving in the meanest wretch, past speaking in a king. Now, good sir, what are you?
A most poor man made tame to fortune's strokes, and prone to pity by experienced sorrows. Give me your hand.
You ever gentle gods, take my breath from me. And let not my ill genius tempt me more to die before you please.
Enter Goneril's gentleman usher.
A proclaimed prize, O most happily met, that eyeless head of thine was first framed flesh to raise my fortunes. Thou old unhappy traitor, the sword is out that must destroy thee.
Now let thy friendly hand put strength enough to it.
Wherefore, bold peasant, there'st thou support a published traitor hence, lest I destroy thee too. Let go his arm.
Chill not let go, sir, without further occasion.
Let go, slave, or thou diest.
Good gentleman, go your gait, and let poor folk pass. And should I have been swaggered out of my life, it would not have been so long as 'tis by a fortnight. Nay, and thou comest near the old man. I'se try whether your costard or my ballow be darder.
Out, dunghill.
Child, pick your teeth, sir. Come, no matter for your vines.
Slave, thou hast slain me. Oh, untimely death.
I know thee well, a serviceable villain, as duteous to the vices of thy mistress as lust could wish.
What, is he dead?
Sit you, sir, and rest you. This is a letter-carrier, and may have some papers of intelligence that may stand our party in good stead to know. What's here?
Takes a letter out of his pocket, opens, and reads.
To Edmund, Earl of Gloucester. Let our mutual loves be remembered. You have many opportunities to cut him off. If he return the conqueror, then I am still a prisoner, and his bed my jail. From the loathed warmth of which deliver me, and supply the place for your labour. Goneril. A plot upon her husband's life, and the exchange my brother. Here are the sands, I'll rake thee up, thou messenger of lust. Grieved only that thou hast no other deathsman. In time and place convenient, I'll produce these letters to the sight of the injured duke, as best shall serve our purpose. Come, your hand. Far off, methinks I hear the beaten drum. Come, sir, I will bestow you with a friend.
Exeunt. Scene 5. A chamber. Lear asleep on a couch, Cordelia and attendants standing by him.
His sleep is sound, and may have good effect, to cure his jarring senses, and repair this breach of nature.
We have employed the utmost power of art, and this deep rest will perfect our design.
O Regan, Goneril, inhumane sisters, had he not been your father, these white hairs had challenged sure some pity. Was this a face to be exposed against the jarring winds? My enemy's dog, though he had bit me, should have stood that night against my fire. He wakes. Speak to him.
Madam, to you, 'tis fittest.
How does my royal lord? How fares your majesty?
You do me wrong to take me out of the grave. Ah, is this too a world of cruelty? I know my privilege. Think not that I will be used still like a wretched mortal. No, no more of that.
Speak to me, sir. Who am I?
You are a soul in bliss, but I am bound upon a wheel of fire, which my own tears do scald like molten lead.
Sir, do you know me?
You are a spirit, I know. Where did you die?
Still, far wide.
Madam, he's scarce awake. He'll soon grow more composed.
Where have I been? Where am I? Fair daylight, I am mightily abused. I should e'en die with pity to see another thus. I will not swear, these are my hands.
Oh, look upon me, sir, and hold your hands in blessing o'er me. Nay, you must not kneel.
Pray, do not mock me. I am a very foolish, fond old man, 80 and upward, and to deal plainly with you, I fear I am not in my perfect mind.
Nay, then farewell to patience. Witness for me, ye mighty powers, I never complained till now.
Methinks I should know you, and know this man, yet I am doubtful, for I am mainly ignorant what place this is, and all the skill I have remembers not these garments, nor do I know where I did sleep last night. Pray do not mock me, for as I am a man, I think that lady to be my child, Cordelia.
Oh, my dear, dear father!
Be your tears wet? Yes, Faith, pray do not weep, for I have given thee cause, and am so humbled with crosses since, that I could ask forgiveness of thee were it possible that thou couldst grant it, but I am well assured thou canst not. Therefore I do stand thy justice. If thou hast poison for me, I will drink it. Bless thee, and die.
Oh, pity, sir, a bleeding heart, and cease this killing language.
Tell me, friends, where am I?
In your own kingdom, sir.
Do not abuse me.
Be comforted, good madam, for the violence of his distempered past will lead him in, nor trouble him, till he is better settled. Will't please you, sir, walk into freer air?
You must bear with me. I am old and foolish.
They lead him off.
The gods restore you. Hark, I hear afar the beaten drum. Old Kent's a man of's word. Oh, for an arm like the fierce thunderers, when the earth-born sun stormed heaven to fight this injured father's battle, that I could shift my sex and dye me deep in his opposer's blood. But as I may with women's weapons, piety and prayers, I'll aid his cause. You never-erring gods, fight on his side and thunder on his foes. Such tempest as his poor aged head sustained, your image suffers when a monarch bleeds. 'Tis your own cause. For that your succors bring, revenge yourselves, and right an injured king.
End of the 4th act. Act 5 of The History of King Lear by Nahum Tate. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Act 5, Scene 1. Scene, a camp. Enter Goneril and attendants.
Our sister's powers already are arrived, and she herself has promised to prevent the night with her approach. Have you provided the banquet I bespoke for her reception at my tent?
So, please your grace, we have.
But thou, my poisoner, must prepare the bowl that crowns this banquet, when our mirth is high, the trumpets sounding and the flutes replying. Then is the time to give this fatal draught to this imperious sister. If then our arms succeed, Edmund, more dear than victory, is mine. But if defeat or death itself attend me,
'Twill charm my ghost to think I've left behind me.
Trumpet.
No happy rival. Hark, she comes.
Exeunt. Scene 2. Enter Bastard in his tent.
To both these sisters have I sworn my love, each jealous of the other as the stung are of the adder. Neither can be held if both remain alive. Where shall I fix? Cornwall is dead, and Regan's empty bed seems cast by fortune for me. But already I have enjoyed her, and bright Goneril with equal charms brings dear variety and yet untasted beauty. I will use her husband's countenance for the battle, then usurp at once his bed and throne.
Enter officers.
My trusty scouts, you're well returned. Have ye descried the strength and posture of the enemy?
We have, and were surprised to find the banished Kent returned, and at their head. Your brother Edgar on the rear, old Gloucester, a moving spectacle, led through their ranks, whose powerful tongue and more prevailing wrongs have so enraged their rustic spirits that with the approaching dawn we must expect their battle.
You bring a welcome hearing, each to his charge. Line well your ranks, and stand on your reward. To-night repose you, and in the morn will give the sun a sight that shall be worth his rising.
Exeunt. Scene 3. Scene. A valley near the camp. Enter Edgar and Gloucester.
Here, sir, take you the shadow of this tree, for your good host. Pray that the right may thrive. If ever I return to you again, I'll bring you comfort.
Exit.
Thanks, friendly sir. The fortune your good cause deserves betide you.
An alarum, after which Gloucester speaks.
Oh, the fight grows hot. The whole war's now at work, and the gored battle bleeds in every vein, whilst drums and trumpets drown loud slaughter's roar. Where's Gloucester now that used to head the fray and scour the ranks where deadliest danger lay? Here, like a shepherd in a lonely shade, idle, unarmed, and listening to the fight. Yet the disabled courser, maimed and blind, when to his stall he hears the rattling war, foaming with rage, tears up the battered ground, and tugs for liberty. No more of shelter, thou blind worm, but forth to the open field. The war may come this way, and crush thee into rest. Here lay thee down, and tear the earth, that work befits a mole. Oh, dark despair! When, Edgar, wilt thou come to pardon and dismiss me to the grave?
A retreat sounded.
Hark, a retreat! The king has lost or won.
Re-enter Edgar, bloody.
Away, old man, give me your hand. Away! King Lear has lost. He and his daughter ta'en, and this, ye gods, is all that I can save of this most precious wreck. Give me your hand.
No farther, sir. A man may rot even here.
What, in ill thoughts again? Men must endure their going hence, even as their coming hither.
And that's true, too.
Exeunt. Scene 4. Flourish. Enter in Conquest, Albany, Goneril, Regan, Bastard. Lear, Kent, Cordelia, prisoners.
It is enough to have conquered. Cruelty should ne'er survive the fight. Captain of the guards, treat well your royal prisoners till you have our further orders, as you hold our pleasure.
Hark, sir, not as you hold our husband's pleasure.
To the captain aside.
But as you hold your life, dispatch your prisoners.
Our empire can have no sure settlement but in their death. The earth that covers them binds fast our throne. Let me hear they are dead.
I shall obey your orders.
Sir, I approve it safest to pronounce sentence of death upon this wretched king, whose age has charms in it, his title more to draw the commons once more to his side, 'twere best prevent.
Sir, by your favour, I hold you but a subject of this war, not as a brother.
That's as we list to grace him. Have you forgot that he did lead our powers, bore the commission of our place and person, and that authority may well stand up and call itself your brother?
Not so hot. In his own merits he exalts himself more than in your addition.
Enter Edgar, disguised.
What art thou?
Pardon me, sir, that I presume to stop a prince and conqueror. Yet ere you triumph, give ear to what a stranger can deliver of what concerns you more than triumph can. I do impeach your general there of treason, Lord Edmund, that usurps the name of Gloucester of foulest practice against your life and honour. This charge is true, and wretched though I seem, I can produce a champion that will prove in single combat what I do avouch. If Edmund dares but trust his cause and sword...
What will not Edmund dare, my lord? I beg the favour that you instantly appoint the place where I may meet this challenger, whom I will sacrifice to my wronged fame. Remember, sir, that injured honour is nice, and cannot brook delay.
Anon, before our tent, in the army's view, there let the herald cry.
I thank your highness in my champion's name. He'll wait your trumpet's call.
Lead.
Exeunt. Scene 5. Manent, Lear, Kent, Cordelia, guarded.
Oh, Kent, Cordelia, you are the only pair that I e'er wronged, and the just gods have made you witnesses of my disgrace, the very shame of fortune, to see me chained and shackled at these years. Yet were you but spectators of my woes, not fellow sufferers, all were well.
This language, sir, adds yet to our affliction.
Thou, Kent, didst head the troops that fought my battle, exposed thy life and fortunes for a master that had, as I remember, banished thee.
Pardon me, sir, that once I broke your orders. Banished by you, I kept me here disguised to watch your fortunes and protect your person. You know you entertained a rough, blunt fellow, one Caius, and you thought he did you service.
My trusty Cajus, I have lost him too.
Weeps.
'Twas a rough honesty.
I was that Caius, disguised in that coarse dress to follow you.
My Cajus too? Wert thou my trusty Cajus? Enough, enough.
Ah me, he faints. His blood forsakes his cheek. Help, Kent!
No, no, they shall not see us weep. We'll see them rot first. Guards, lead away to prison. Come, Kent. Cordelia, come. We two will sit alone, like birds of the cage. When thou dost ask me blessing, I'll kneel down and ask of thee forgiveness. Thus we'll live, and pray, and sing, and tell old tales, and laugh at gilded butterflies, hear sycophants talk of court news, and we'll talk with them too, who loses and who wins, who's in, who's out, and take upon us the mystery of things, as if we were heaven's spies.
Upon such sacrifices the gods themselves throw incense.
Have I caught ye? He that parts us must bring a brand from heaven. Together we'll out-toil the spite of hell, and die the wonders of the world. Away!
Exeunt, guarded. Scene 6. Flourish. Enter before the tents, Albany, Goneril, Regan, guards and attendants. Goneril speaking apart to the captain of the guards entering.
Here's gold for thee. Thou know'st our late command upon your prisoners' lives. About it straight.
and at our evening banquet let it raise our mirth to hear that they are dead.
I shall not fail your orders.
Exit. Albany, Goneril, Regan, take their seats.
Now, Gloucester, trust to thy single virtue, for thy soldiers, all levied in my name, have, in my name, took their discharge. Now let our trumpets speak. And, herald, read out this.
Reads.
If any man of quality within the lists of the army will maintain upon Edmund, supposed Earl of Gloucester, that he is manifold traitor, let him appear by the third sound of the trumpet. He is bold in his defence. Again, again.
Trumpet answers from within. Enter Edgar, armed.
Lord Edgar.
Ha! My brother! This is the only combatant that I could fear, for in my breast guilt duels on his side. But, conscience, what have I to do with thee? Or thou thy dull legitimate slaves? But I was born a libertine, and so I keep me.
My noble prince, a word ere we engage. Into your highness's hands I give this paper. It will the truth of my impeachment prove, whatever be my fortune in the fight.
We shall peruse it.
Now, Edmund, draw thy sword, that if my speech has wronged a noble heart, thy arm may do thee justice. Here are the presents of this high prince, these queens, and this crowned list. I brand thee with the spotted name of traitor, false to thy gods, thy father and thy brother, and what is more, thy friend, false to this prince. If then thou sharest a spark of Gloucester's virtue, acquit thyself, or if thou sharest his courage, meet this defiance bravely.
And dares Edgar, the beaten, routed Edgar, brave his conqueror? From all thy troops and thee I forced the field. Thou hast lost the general stake, and art thou now come with thy petty single stock to play this after-game?
Half-blooded man, thy father sinned first, then his punishment. The dark and vicious place where he begot thee cost him his eyes. From thy licentious mother thou drawest thy villainy. But for thy part of Gloucester's blood I hold thee worth my sword.
Thou bearest thee on thy mother's piety, which I despise. Thy mother being chaste, thou art assured thou art but Gloucester's son. But mine, disdaining constancy, leaves me to hope that I am sprung from nobler blood, and possibly a king might be my sire. But be my birth's uncertain chance as 'twill, who 'twas that had the hit to father me, I know not. 'Tis enough that I am I. Of this one thing I'm certain, that I have a daring soul, and so have at thy heart. Sound, trumpet!
Fight. Bastard falls.
Save him! This was practice, Gloucester. Thou wantst the field, and wast not bound to fight a vanquished enemy. Thou art not conquered, but cozened and betrayed.
Shut your mouth, lady, or with this paper I shall stop it. Hold, sir, thou worse than any name, read thy own evil. No tearing, lady, I perceive you know it.
Say, if I do, who shall arraign me for't? The laws are mine, not thine.
Most monstrous! Ah, thou know'st it too.
Ask me not what I know. I have not breath to answer idle questions.
I have resolved. Your right, brave sir, has conquered.
To Edgar.
Along with me, I must consult your father.
Exeunt Albany and Edgar.
Help every hand to save a noble life. My half of the kingdom for a man of skill to stop this precious stream.
Away, ye empericks! Torment me not with your vain offices. The sword has pierced too far. Legitimacy at last has got it.
The pride of nature dies.
Away! The minutes are too precious. Disturb us not with thy impertinent sorrow.
Art thou my rival, then, professed?
Why, was our love a secret? Could there be beauty like mine, and gallantry like his, and not a mutual love? Just nature then had erred. Behold that copy of perfection, that youth,
whose story will have no foul page but where it says he stooped to Regan's arms, which yet was but compliance, not affection, a charity to begging, ruined beauty.
Who begged when Goneril writ that? Expose it.
Throws her a letter.
And let it be your army's mirth, as 'twas this charming youth's and mine, when in the bower he breathed the warmest ecstasies of love, then, panting on my breast, cried, Matchless Regan, that Goneril and thou should e'er be kin.
Die, Circe, for thy charms are at an end. Expire before my face, and let me see how well that boasted beauty will become congealing blood, and death's convulsive pangs. Die and be hushed, for at my tent last night thou drankst thy bane, amidst thy revelling bowls. Ha! Dost thou smile? Is then thy death thy sport, or has the trusty potion made thee mad?
Thou comest as short of me in thy revenge as in my Gloucester's love. My jealousy inspired me to prevent thy feeble malice and poison thee at thy own banquet.
Ha!
No more, my queens, of this untimely strife. You both deserved my love, and both possess it. Come, soldiers, bear me in, and let your royal presence grace my last minutes. Now, Edgar, thy proud conquest I forgive. Who would not choose, like me, to yield his breath, to have rival queens contend for him in death?
Exeunt. Scene 7. Scene, a prison. Lear asleep, with his head on Cordelia's lap.
What toils, thou wretched king, hast thou endured, to make thee draw, in chains, a sleep so sound? Thy better angel charm thy ravished mind with fancied freedom. Peace is us to lodge. On cottage straw thou hast the beggar's bed, therefore shouldst have the beggar's careless thought. And now, my Edgar, I remember thee. What fate has seized thee in this general wreck, I know not. But I know thou must be wretched, because Cordelia holds thee dear. O gods, a sedain gloom overwhelms me, and the image of death o'erspreads the place. Ha! Who are these?
Enter captain and officers with cords.
Now, sirs, dispatch. Already you are paid in part. The best of your rewards to come.
Charge, charge upon their flank, their last wing halts. Push, push the battle, and the day's our own. Their ranks are broke, down, down with Albany. Who holds my hands? Oh, thou deceiving sleep, I was this very minute on the chase, and now a prisoner here. What mean the slaves? You will not murder me?
Help earth and heaven, for your souls' sakes, dear sirs, and for the gods.
No tears, good lady, no pleading against gold and preferment. Come, sirs, make ready your cords.
You, sir, all seas, you have a humane form, and if no prayers can touch your soul to spare a poor king's life, if there be anything that you hold dear, by that I beg you to dispatch me first.
Comply with her request. Dispatch her first.
Off, hellhounds! By the gods, I charge you, spare her. 'Tis my Cordelia, my true pious daughter. No pity? Nay, then, take an old man's vengeance.
Snatches a partisan and strikes down two of them. The rest quit Cordelia and turn upon him. Enter Edgar and Albany.
Death, hell! Ye vultures, hold your impious hands, or take a speedier death than you would give.
By whose command?
Behold the Duke your lord.
Gods, seize those instruments of cruelty.
My Edgar, oh!
My dear Cordelia, lucky was the minute of our approach. The gods have weighed our sufferings. We are past the fire, and now must shine to ages.
Look here, my lord, see where the generous king has slain two of them.
Did I not, fellow? I've seen the day. With my good biting falchion I could have made em skip. I am old now. and these vile crosses spoil me. Out of breath, fie, oh, quite out of breath and spent.
Bring in old Kent, and, Edgar, guide you hither your father, whom you said was near.
Exit Edgar.
He may be an ear witness at the least of our proceedings.
Kent brought in here.
Who are you? My eyes are none of the best, I'll tell you straight. Oh, Albany, well, sir, we are your captives, and you are come to see death pass upon us. Why this delay? Or is't your highness' pleasure to give us first the torture? Say ye so? Why, here's old Kent and I, as tough a pair as e'er bore tyrant's stroke. But my Cordelia, my poor Cordelia here, oh, pity!
Take off their chains. Thou injured majesty, the wheel of fortune now has made her circle, and blessings yet stand twixt thy grave and thee.
Com'st thou, inhumane lord, to soothe us back to a fool's paradise of hope, to make our doom more wretched? Go to, we are too well acquainted with misfortune to be gulled with lying hope. No, we will hope no more.
I have a tale to unfold so full of wonder as cannot meet an easy faith. But by that royal injured head, 'tis true.
What would your highness?
Know the noble Edgar impeached Lord Edmund since the fight of treason, and dared him for the proof to single combat, in which the gods confirmed his charge by conquest. I left e'en now the traitor wounded mortally.
And whither tends this story?
Ere they fought, Lord Edgar gave into my hands this paper, a blacker scrawl of treason and of lust than can be found in the records of hell. There, sacred sir, behold the character of Goneril, the worst of daughters, but more vicious wife.
Could there be yet addition to their guilt? What will not they that wrong a father do?
Since then my injuries, Lear, fall in with thine. I have resolved the same redress for both.
What says my lord?
Speak, for me thought I heard the charming voice of a descending god.
The troops by Edmund raised, I have disbanded. Those that remain are under my command. What comfort may be brought to cheer your age and heal your savage wrongs shall be applied, for to your majesty we do resign your kingdom, save what part yourself conferred on us in marriage.
Hear you that, my liege?
Then there are gods, and virtue is their care.
Is't possible? Let the spheres stop their course, the sun make halt, the winds be hushed, the seas and fountains rest, all nature pause and listen to the change. Where is my Kent, my Cajus?
Here, my liege.
Why, I have news that will recall thy youth. Ha! Didst thou hear't? Or did the inspiring gods whisper to me alone? Old Lear shall be a king again.
The prince that like a god has power has said it.
Cordelia then shall be a queen, mark that. Cordelia shall be queen. Winds, catch the sound and bear it on your rosy wings to heaven. Cordelia is a queen.
Re-enter Edgar with Gloucester.
Look, sir, where pious Edgar comes, leading his eyeless father. O my liege, his wondrous story will deserve your leisure. What he has done and suffered for your sake, what for the fair Cordelia's.
Where is my liege? Conduct me to his knees to hail his second birth of empire. My dear Edgar has with himself revealed the king's blessed restoration.
My poor dark Gloucester.
Oh, let me kiss that once more sceptred hand.
Hold, thou mistakest the majesty. Kneel here. Cordelia has our power, Cordelia's queen. Speak, is not that the noble suffering Edgar?
My pious son, more dear than my lost eyes.
I wronged him too, but here's the fair amends.
Your leave, my liege, for an unwelcome message. Edmund, but that's a trifle, is expired. What more will touch you? Your imperious daughters, Goneril and haughty Regan, both are dead. Each by the other poisoned at a banquet. This dying they confessed.
O fatal period of ill-governed life!
Ingrateful as they were, my heart feels yet a pang of nature for their wretched fall. But, Edgar, I defer thy joys too long. Thou serv'st distressed Cordelia. Take her crowned, the imperial grace fresh blooming on her brow. Nay, Gloucester, thou hast here a father's right, thy helping hand to heap blessings on their head.
Old Kent throws in his hearty wishes too.
The gods and you too largely recompense what I have done. The gift strikes merit dumb.
Nor do I blush to own myself overpaid for all my sufferings past.
Now, gentle gods, give Gloucester his discharge.
No, Gloucester, thou hast business yet for life. Thou, Kent, and I, retired to some cool cell, will gently pass our short reserves of time in calm reflections on our fortunes past, cheered with the relation of the prosperous reign of this celestial pair. Thus our remains shall in an even course of thought be passed, enjoy the present hour, nor fear the last.
Our drooping country now erects her head. Peace spreads her balmy wings, and plenty blooms. Divine Cordelia, all the gods can witness how much thy love to empire I prefer. Thy bright example shall convince the world, whatever storms of fortune are decreed, that truth and virtue shall at last succeed.
Exeunt omnes. Finis. Epilogue.
Inconstancy, the reigning sin of the age, will scarce endure true lovers on the stage. You hardly, even in plays, with such dispense, and poets kill 'em in their own defence. Yet one bold proof I was resolved to give, that I could 3 hours' constancy outlive. You fear, perhaps, whilst on the stage we are made such saints, we shall indeed take up the trade. Sometimes we threaten. But our virtue may, for truth, I fear, with your pit valour weigh. For not to flatter either, I much doubt when we are off the stage and you are out, we are not quite so coy, nor you so stout. We talk of nunneries, but to be sincere, whoever lives to see us cloistered there may hope to meet our critics at Tangier. For shame, give over this inglorious trade of worrying poets, and go maul the Alcade. Well, since you're all for blustering in the pit, this play's reviver humbly does admit your absolute power to damn his part of it. But still so many master touches shine of that vast hand that first laid this design, that in great Shakespeare's right he's bold to say, if you like nothing you have seen to-day, the play your judgment damns, not you the play.
End of Act 5. End of The History of King Lear by Nahum Tate.